Now, for most of the time that we've been here, the definition of our life of freedom was fairly tangible. It was very concrete. We had chains on our wrists. We had manacles on our ankles. We had hoops around our necks. We had dogs restricting our movement. There were guns standing at the fence. There were very tangible, concrete limitations on our access to movement that made it very clear that something is wrong. The opportunity and the effort to engage in those things that other human beings engage in, the opportunity to be with our children, to be with our wives, to engage in the kinds of things that we had known characteristically and other people were able to do, we weren't able to do those things. So freedom came to mean getting away from the chains, getting away from the manacles, getting away from the limitations, breaking loose from the plantation, outrunning the dog, outrunning the hunter, outrunning the bounty, outrunning those people who wanted to keep us in that condition, to get away from the whip, get away from the oppressor who was clear and evident by his physical existence. So for most of those 200 years, we did all we could to get free, but freedom meant getting away from the physical condition of slavery. During those days, the Negroes were far and few between, because everybody knew they were in hell. Now, there were people frightened about doing anything about it, but they knew they were in trouble. No one had to convince them that their situation was a contemptible, degraded, pitiful, sad situation. Except for a few of them, of course, who'd gotten to hang out in the house and they thought they were what they were working at. But basically, most of the slaves knew full well that something is going on. Now, under those conditions, the pressure was to get away from the conditions of the plantation, and that was the definition of freedom. If we can just get up north, if we can just get away from the dog, if we can just get away from the whip, if we can just get away from this mean cracker, then we will be free. So the concept of liberation was migration. Plantation in Virginia and Carolina and Georgia and Mississippi and Kentucky, and let me get to the free land up north. So the concept of freedom was a very simple one. After the period of slavery, the concept of freedom became slightly different. It became one of, now that the chains are off, now that the fences are removed, now that the dogs are no longer put on us, now that you no longer have a right to deprive me of the ability to move, then it became clear that even though those things were gone, freedom still was not there. So it became a little less tangible. Even though you couldn't vote, and even though you couldn't walk on the same side of the street, and even though you had to drink out of a special fountain, and even though your children had to go to special schools and you had to live in special areas, the idea, though, was that somehow it was still less tangible. It was less clear. It was more abstract. But people knew something still was wrong, so they said, freedom means let me participate. So they said, boss, now that the chains are gone, you do. Let me go where you go, eat where you go, go to the bathroom where you go to the bathroom. Let me live where you live, and let my children go where yours go. And our concept of freedom then became one of participation. And so for almost a half of a century, we worked hard to participate. We wanted to simply do what Boss did. And if we were doing what Boss was doing, we thought we were free. And we made lots of efforts to try to do what Boss did. We prayed, we marched, we sat in, we walked in, we voted, we unvoted, we got beaten down in the streets. We did everything just trying to let Boss let us participate. Because the concept of freedom then was just to be able to do what Boss was doing. Then we kept finding out something still ain't right. It still ain't right. So I tell you what, Boss, let us be like you. We want to marry you and listen. We want to go to your school. We don't want no these colored schools. We want to go to your school, Boss. We don't want to have no black community. We want to live integrated. No longer no participation. We want to integrate. We want to live right next to you. We want to pray next to you. We want to sing next to you. We want to do everything right with you. Don't give us none of this old black stuff. None of this old African stuff. I'm an American, Boss. I'm a real American. And once we began to push for that, we didn't want nothing to keep us from being a good American. We wanted to fight where Boss fought. We wanted to go to his war, live in his way. So the thrust then had gone from plantation to participation to membership. We wanted to be shared members, and we thought we'd be free. Now, as we come to the end of this 20th century, we are in a period of real complexity, because all tangible evidence suggests we ought to be free. Ain't no chains, no plantation, no laws prohibiting you from voting for who they want you to vote for. No barriers to going to whatever school you want to try to go to. Any book you want to read, you can read it. Turn on TV, colored people everywhere, doing all the things that white folks do. Being molested, learning how to molest, having dysfunctional families, being psychoneurotic. We got them all. Listen. We got them all. Negroes on the Supreme Court, married to white women. So what you want? What's the complaint? What's the dissatisfaction now? We have Negro editorialists and journalists who get in the newspaper and write penetrating editorials to argue against the continued victimization, preoccupation with being victimized, because the content of the character is what really counts rather than the substantive realization that we are really free. Listen, we have right-wing conservative Republicans who tell the Negroes they ought to shut up and stop complaining. They got everything they need. They're just addicted to complaint, complain, complain, complain. I'm free, you free, what you want to be. It's all there, because now it's not as tangible anymore. But the majority of folks still know something is wrong. Every time you look at a statistic that reflects negative things, we at the top. Dying from cancer, we at the top. Dying from AIDS, we at the top. Highest poverty, we at the top. Most welfare, we at the top. Everything that has to do with death, destruction, degradation, destruction of our lives and our children's lives, we at the top. And even though we have representatives who look like us, city high peaks of authority. The bottom line is that we are still plantation existing Negroes. That is the bottom line reality. So the question becomes, well, it answers one question. It lets us understand why it is so difficult now to let out, to get most of our people to understand there's a problem. Because an illusion has been created. An illusion has been created that we now are just like everybody else. And most of our people have come to believe that that's the way it is. Not most of them, many of our people. Many of our people, they believe that that's the way it is. So when you come to them and say, look, we got to get free. Time's running out. Our condition is getting worse. They say, what are you talking about? Oprah is one of the richest people in America. What are you talking about?
In any race of people, the most instinctively revolutionary people is the youth. Because the youth is always willing to act. In anybody's race.